It's our great honor to reintroduce Professor Sukhatme today for his second lecture. As all of you might be aware, he delivered a wonderful and a very captivating lecture yesterday about the future needs of the future energy requirements in India. And he also talked about what is the general direction India should go based on the examples of various developed nations. So today, today's lecture will be somewhat more, so it will be expanding upon what policy India should follow to meet the energy requirement and to get past the so-called energy insecurity. So with that, a big round of applause for Professor Sukhatme, and I'll hand over the stage to him.
Good evening, everybody. Good to see you all again. Today we'll continue from where I left off. And if you recall, this was the second slide yesterday, and I'm just repeating the order of the topics as I cover them. We stopped after completing topic number 3 yesterday. So the bulk of today's lecture is on topic number 4, which is the main thing of interest to us in this whole, in this two lecture series. So I just thought I would reproduce this and show it to you again before we move on to where we left off yesterday. Now, I don't know of any easier way of going there. Okay, this is where we now begin. We'll now talk about the potential of renewable energy sources in India and estimate what they can give us in the future, estimate the electricity they can give us in the future. And after doing that, I'm going to come to the technical part. What are the challenges in doing this? One challenge, of course, is money. When you go to something new, you have to pay for all that. That's, of course, a challenge. But the second is there are technical challenges which not just India, but all countries which want to use photovoltaics and wind on a large scale are going to face in the future. So I'll spend some time on those, because that's where technologies and science and all has to be still developed to do in a way that we would like. Now, for estimating the capacity of renewable energy sources, what I've done is I've listed the sources which come under solar energy. First of all, let me say this. Solar energy falls directly on us, like I stand in the sun, I'm hit by the sun's rays. And if I want to use it directly, the two ways of generating electricity are, number one, put a photovoltaic panel in the sun, electricity is generated. Secondly, if you are a solar thermal person, you will use the sun's energy to heat up some fluid, say water, generate steam from that water. That means you will need concentrating collectors, large concentrating collectors. After getting steam, you will run a regular steam power station. The steam is expanded in a turbine, generates work. The work is converted to electricity in a generator, electric generator. You understand? So there are two broad ways of using solar energy directly. Normally, people don't use the word direct and indirect for solar energy, but that's really what it comes to. All the other energy that we see around which we can tap, like wind energy, or for instance, hydroelectric power, are all indirect manifestations because the sun is giving us energy. Why does the wind blow around us? Because the sun heats the earth's surface differentially, and of course the earth is rotating, and therefore because of that wind flows in certain directions on the surface of the earth, and we tap that wind energy. So keep in mind, the wind is really the sun indirectly coming back to you. Or hydroelectric power, when water falls in a river and flows down through a river, you stop it with a dam, you get a head of water, you let that water flow through a pipe and hit a water turbine, you generate power. You understand? So finally, whatever be the thing, whatever be the way, it's really either using solar directly or solar indirectly. And nowadays, the terminology is when people say solar, they mean the direct way, that is photovoltaics and solar thermal. And the other ones are referred to by name, wind, hydroelectric power, and see, I've listed many of them for you in the indirect forms. Hydroelectric power, wind energy, then power from biomass, wave energy, marine currents, ocean thermal energy conversion, tidal energy. These are all ways of using the sun's power indirectly. The ones that I've underlined there are the ones where are at such a stage that we can now tap them commercially on a large scale. All right. Everything has a potential, but finally it comes to the cost of making the devices which will, from that indirect source, get electricity. And so far, what we have found is the ones that I have underlined are, there is differences in prices, of course, economically, but they are at a stage where we can think of using them on a reasonably large scale. By large scale, I mean, you know, in megawatts at least, not kilowatts. A kilowatt is not a large scale when you talk about a country, you understand? Kilowatt is a lot of energy at home. When I use 1 kilowatt power something, things like that. So keep in mind, the ones underlined are the ones which have at the moment potential. But don't rule out the other ones which I have named there. Some of them 50 years from today may well be big energy sources as well for getting electricity. For instance, just to give you an example how things have changed, 50 years ago or so, when the first talk began that we should use solar energy for electricity and for other purposes on a large scale, photovoltaic, people said, is something for generating a few watts of power. The first photovoltaic cells were built in Bell Labs in 1960s, 50 years ago. And each watt of power on the cells cost more than $10,000. That was the first photovoltaic cells built just 50 years ago. Today, a typical megawatt station, we have megawatt stations of solar photovoltaics, and a typical photovoltaic power station per megawatt would cost perhaps in rupees crores, maybe about 8 crores. A coal-fired station, 1 megawatt, probably cost us 3 crores. You understand? So, photovoltaics still costlier than, say, a coal-fired station, but look at the change that has occurred over the years. So, let's not say the others which are not ruled, underlined, that they'll stay forever out of our reach. You never know which one out of these will come up. If I were to hazard a guess for you, I would say ocean thermal energy conversion is unlikely to be a source, big source of energy. Enough has been done about it, and though I am a thermal person, I am sad to say this, it's unlikely that ocean thermal energy conversion will be a source, a big source of electricity in the future, simply because the temperature difference which is being used there is the temperature difference between the surface of the sea and the 200 meters down in the sea. And that temperature difference, even in tropical waters, is typically at the most 15 or 20 degrees centigrade. And people have tried to build power cycles with that temperature difference, and they found the efficiencies are, you know, the typical efficiencies of the order of 1 or 2%. And that's no way that ever something like that is going to be economic. So really work, research work on such plants, which are called OTEC plants, has almost stopped all over the world. They were tried out, tested on experimental pilot scales, sort of given up. But you never know with the others, like marine currents may well be a source, big source of power in the future for generating electricity. You understand? So I'm not saying don't look at the ones that are not underlined. We don't know how things will go. So our focus today, having said this in general, will be on the ones that are underlined, because we want to at the moment say, with current technology, what do we think these sources can give us in terms of power in India as we go along over the next 10, 20, 30 years? So now let's move on. I'm going to take them one by one. First, solar energy, photovoltaic and thermal. Okay. first today's picture. Right now in India today, the installed capacity of PV is already 21,500 megawatts, and it's every year going up by about 10,000 at least. It's at a fast track thing, because you know, they are available, and we are putting in money because it's a very reliable source of power. So PV plant is very nice for a mechanical engineer because nothing moves, you understand. You put it there, it does its job. You love such devices, and all you have to do is to keep cleaning the glass regularly, and that's it. So it's a lovely device in that sense, and they are at a stage where they're really paying off now. And that is why, as the amount of energy being generated increases, as the number of plants increases, the price has also been steadily falling. The unfortunate part, or the negative side of it, is all solar PV power in India is imported. All our PV panels, with hardly 1 or 2 or 5% being made in India. All right, that's the unfortunate part. And the country which has taken over PV power, which makes the PV cells on large scales, is China. China didn't make PV cells 10 years ago. All were coming from USA or Germany and like that. They've taken over the market. Some of the US companies which are leading have stopped working simply because they can't match the price which the Chinese sell at. So keep in mind, I talked about energy insecurity yesterday. You remember I said we are importing our oil. So while I am telling you this about PV power, our insecurity may not change if tomorrow China says, thank you very much for buying all this PV power, we are not selling to you anymore. What do you do? So there are issues also with PV power. The plus side is, at the moment they want to sell, we want to buy, and like other countries, we are buying from China. Okay. What is even more important to note is that our plans for expanding power, PV power, are very ambitious in India. India is leading in that sense in the world in trying to quickly set up PV power. And roughly, it is planned that we will have 100,000 megawatts by 2022, that's 4 years from today. This plan started about 5 years ago, it's not new, and the goal has been set by 2022. We should have 100,000 megawatts of PV power and 75,000 megawatts of wind energy. That's the goal that the government has said, and in fact has given that as a one of the ways we will what you call satisfy the promises which we made at Paris when we had a big convention of all the countries of the world 2 years ago. So PV plants are under erection in India, and that's the goal that has been set. What are the issues? The issue is still cost. I mean, still they're costly. Costs have come down, but still, it's about 8 to 10 crores per megawatt peak. Okay, that's important to know. It's still a high cost device. And the second thing, which also has to be noted, is you need 2 hectares per megawatt. Okay, I mean, this 2 hectares comes from the efficiency of solar cells. You want the sun's rays to fall, you know what's the radiation falling typically, you multiply that by the efficiency, you get an idea. You have to leave some space between panels because you don't want them side by side, the shadow of one will fall on the other. You have to leave some space in between panels for cleaning them. Keeping all that in mind, typically you'll need about 2 hectares a megawatt. Now again, 2 hectares is not that big, you know, so what, but multiply that by 100,000 megawatts, okay? And then you immediately see you're talking of a lot of land as a requirement, okay? That's the point which has to be appreciated. I'll come back to that in a moment. The second limitation, or the second limitation which nature imposes on us, is the direct rays of the sun are typically available for 7, 8 or 9 hours a day. I mean, you can't get away from that. So that's also a limitation. None of us wants electricity during the day only. We want electricity around the clock. We are now, so to speak, we want electricity at the click of a button. We don't say, when the sun is there, I'll be happy with electricity. Those days are no longer with us. So that's a limitation, and we have to work around it, obviously, in order to get power all the time. Okay. Now we ask the question, with this as the current setting for PV power, we say, well, how much energy can we expect to generate from solar energy? Now, let me say one more thing. I've clubbed PV and thermal together. I'll use the terms for this part of the discussion, simply because the land requirement is about the same. The efficiency of conversion overall is about the same. At the moment, PV is getting favored because it's less costly. Okay? But thermal has some advantages, which also I'll come to in a moment. But at the moment, almost all our investment is going in PV thermal power plant in India. Now, land is the issue. And it is something which people do not understand, that you are now talking of not a few hectares here and there, but thousands of hectares of land to be used for putting PV panels. This land cannot be agricultural land. You can't take that away. We need our crops to be growing. It cannot be forest land, right? It has to be barren, arid land which has to be used for this purpose. And in India today, barren, uncultivated land or not suitable for cultivation is only 200,000 square kilometers. Okay? That's about, 6% of our land area, roughly, or 7%, something like that, of the total land area of India. That's what we call as barren, uncultivated land, which could be used, which could be tapped, or can be used for such purposes, because it doesn't stop other activity. You understand? And we now say, well, how much of this land can you acquire? You can't go around saying, okay, I'll take all of it. Nothing of the kind. I mean, somebody says, I'll put PV fault. Much of this land is in Rajasthan, North Gujarat, you know, parts of the Deccan Plateau. This is where all our barren, arid land is. You can't just take over all of it. There are people staying there. There are so many other things happening. So typically, people say, look, if I want to acquire this land, 5% is reasonable. 10 maybe, at the most, if you discuss it with people, you'll say maybe 20% can be acquired over a period of time, obviously. Acquired means you pay for it, because let me tell you, people who understand how to make investments have already bought up land in these areas. Okay? And you may know who I'm referring to also, if you know, read politics. Okay? People have bought up this land. They know it's going to be valuable, they've bought it. So land is the issue for India when it comes to getting large amounts of electricity. It is an issue, and we think we are a big country in size. We are big, but we also have a large population. We have large needs for electricity. So let me just do a calculation with 5%. I'll show you the same calculation, just multiply it 2 times, you'll get 10% the answer. So let's do it for 5%. Say, all right, I acquire 5% of this land. That comes to at 2 hectares per megawatt, that means I could generate 500,000 megawatts from that. Now, this means I'm now putting in the efficiency of the PV plant there when I get that answer of 500,000 megawatts. You understand how I'm getting it. A typical annual plant load factor for a PV plant is very low. It's only 0.18 for all the plants that are not just in India but even abroad. Why is it low? Because the sun only shines for 8 hours a day. That's number one. Number two, when we say it's a 10 megawatt plant, it's what is called as 10 megawatt peak plant. So the way it is standardized, a PV plant, is if on a PV panel 1000 watts per square meter sun is falling, that's the radiation falling, then the efficiency that you get is for a peak power. So when we say I've got a 100 megawatt peak plant, that's what we mean, that we need 1000 watts per square meter falling on it for 24 hours a day, then you've got a plant load factor of 1, annual plant load factor of 1. Now you have the sun shining only for 8 hours a day or 9 hours a day, even if it's a clear day, forget cloudy days, a clear day. And even in that, the peak power, peak value is probably 800, 900 watts per square meter on a hot day in Ahmedabad. So the average value over 8, 9 hours is typically about 500 watts per square meter. You understand why the peak, the annual plant factor is low? Is it's built into using solar energy. Typically values are 0.18. So if I want to calculate how much power, how much energy I'll get from that power. You multiply that 500,000, by the number of hours in the year, by the plant load factor, and then in order to get the answer in terawatt hours, you divide it by 1 million. This converts the answer into terawatt hours. Got it? It's just simple, but you should know how, because now in the next stage, I'll just give the numbers. Now, still, even with 5% of the land being acquired, photovoltaics are set to give you potentially a fair amount of electricity. 788 terawatt hours is not a small amount of electricity. I gave you yesterday what the whole of India generates just now from all our plants. It's around 1300 terawatt hours. You understand? So it's not a small amount, it's a big amount which we can get eventually over a period of 30, 40 years. But that's the kind of potential we have with photovoltaic power. Now I say, all right, since we are doing futurology and estimate for the future, let's not just be leave it at that, let's do an estimate. So we say, all right, now I'll put forward some numbers. If it's 5% land I acquire, so I get 788 terawatt hours. With 10% it's twice that, with 20% it's 3,153 terawatt hours. So it's a huge amount of electricity which can be generated from photovoltaics, if huge amount of energy which we can generate over a period of time, and therefore photovoltaic is a big potential for us, has a very large potential for us in the future. Keep in mind also the number I gave you yesterday. I said, if every individual in the country gets 4,000 kilowatt hours per year and our population stabilizes at 1,700 million, then we need 6,800 terawatt hours. You're talking about a very sizable part of that right here from one component, that is PV power. So PV, if we can master the thing, if we have the money obviously to buy it, that stands there. But there is a very big potential for generating electricity from photovoltaics for us. Okay, now we'll move on. Like this, one by one, now I'll look at various things. Take reasonable numbers for what exists with technologies today. That's what I'm doing. Now, just to break the monotony, you know, why not see an actual plant? Look, it's well, in photographs, everything looks nice and neat. So you see how neatly all those arrays are there. Here's a 5 megawatt plant in Andhra Pradesh, okay. And that's one good thing, as I said, about photovoltaics. Once it's set up, there's very little to do excepting to have water spraying done at regular intervals so that this glass stays clean. Beyond that, it works well. Now let me go further, show you another one. I told you already land is an issue. Here's a plant in Gujarat on the Narmada Canal going northward to Saurashtra. They've already built a PV plant over the canal here, right here, somewhere near Ahmedabad. I haven't seen it myself. Now this is a very nice idea because it's not, the weight of plants is not all that much. You just have to have a truss over the canal and you use that land. That becomes land for you. The canal doesn't mind the sun's rays being obstructed. In fact, it lowers the evaporation of water from the canal. You understand? So it's a good application to understand that we should already be looking out for ways of using these plants in areas where people don't mind the sun being obstructed, don't mind if the sun is obstructed. Just I thought I'd mention this. Now we go to the next type. PV also can be used since they are modular in size. A typical PV panel is about 2 square meters in size. That's a size which is readily available all over the world. Okay, about 2 square meters. So over rooftops, all over, whether they be urban areas or rural areas, there's a possibility of generating a fair amount of electricity. This will now be in kilowatts, because any rooftop typically will be how much? 1,000 square feet at the most, or 500 square feet. But you can put PV panels if you have an orientation towards the sun and get something. If you don't have shade, trees around it which shade it and things like that. How much can we generate that way? And there is a potential. It's not that large, but it exists. So typically a rooftop system with say 1,000 square feet will generate 3 kilowatts of power. You can do the same calculation that I showed you earlier, all right. And from 3 kilowatts, again using the same plant load factor, that's the same 0.18, you can show that it will generate 4.5 megawatt hours per year. Okay, a typical plant, on an average, 1,000 square feet or 30 square meters that is being used. Now, how many such systems can one expect to install? That's again the question of how many million rooftops can I put such plants on? And again, we estimate, we make a good guess. Typical guess is, first of all, how many households do we have? First let me say this, urban areas have very little potential for putting PV, because urban areas have roads, buildings which are not single storied and things like that. There is some potential, but even in the city of Mumbai, a survey was done, how many open rooftops have we got where we can put PV, and the total estimate for the whole of Mumbai came to some few megawatts, which is nothing for the size of Mumbai. So really speaking, rooftop installations have a future in smaller towns and villages where you have few hundred square feet on the roof or in some way open which can be utilized. A typical estimate is that we might have about 400 million households in the country in 30 years. You divide 1700 million by 4, typical family is 4 nowadays in India. You understand, that's the calculation that's done. So you end up with 400 million households. Half of them are likely to be in villages or urban, not villages, but rural areas, and half in cities. That's the rough kind of thing that has been thought of. And that's typically the trend towards which we are heading. So, in those rural areas, how many such systems can we install? Again, the same answer, maybe 10%. Maybe something like 20%, you know, of that order. It can't be much, much more than that. There are trees around houses which block the sun from falling on a rooftop and things like that as well. So let me just give you an estimate again. If I say that I can do this on 5 million households, one could generate 22.5 terawatt hours. If I can go up to 20 million households eventually, 30, 40 years from today, I could probably get 90 terawatt hours. So it's not trivial again, every terawatt hour is important, but rooftops have a limitation in terms of their availability and how many we can install. And the economy also goes down a little, because every rooftop installation has to have all the auxiliaries you lose. You see, you lose the economy which comes with scale. A 3 kilowatt station will still require a small inverter and to convert, and if you want to connect it to the main line again in order to use it, if you want to use it yourself, it's fine. If you want to convert it and use it, then again you lose the initial cost, you pay up more for it, things like that. So a typical estimate is that we might generate something of this order. Again, anyone can argue in some way, say a little more and less, and it's possible, but I think we are in the right ballpark. I might tell you that in the mission that's going on just now for photovoltaic in the country, the estimate was that we would have at least 40, I gave you the number for this thing, for solar photovoltaics there, and I said that we're looking forward to install it. In that, an estimate was given that we would have at least 40,000 megawatts by 2022 of solar rooftop. And that's not, already the trend show, that's not happening. We are far behind there, but in solar PV installations which are in open land, the rate is as was estimated a few years ago. So this may happen eventually, but it's still going to be a small contributor to the total. Now I won't spend that much time on each. The first thing I've taken in detail to say how we arrive at numbers. Now we'll go quickly through that. The next major thing for us is hydroelectric power. Already a large amount of electricity comes from hydroelectric power in the country. It's not trivial as it stands. And we have a fairly good estimate of our reserves. You see, long ago, the Central Water Power Commission had studies of the flows in our major rivers and minor rivers where you can put up dams and generate hydroelectric power. These studies are available, and the potential for each river has been estimated, how much power you can generate, and is the long listings are available showing that we could probably generate that number 148,700 megawatts from hydroelectric power from the flows in the rivers. This has been estimated reasonably scientifically, because you actually measure flows in rivers during the during various seasons. And right now, I don't have the latest figure, but say April 2017, we had about 44,594 megawatts already installed. India has an old history of having hydroelectric power stations. I hope you know that. The first hydroelectric power station was in Mysore when Sir Visveshwaraya was the Diwan of Mysore. You understand? So the big one where we have the gardens now, Vrindavan Gardens, near Bangalore, near Mysore, Bangalore, that area. So already a sizable part of that 148,000 we've tapped. 48,000, 45,000 has already been tapped. There's scope for more. And again, we say to ourselves, how much can we get? If I tap 40% of the power, I can get 193 terawatt hours. The plant load factor is known for hydroelectric power stations. It's this much. Again, you'll ask me, why is it much less than one? And the reason is simple. These values are for peak powers. Peak power you can generate when the dam is fully full, just after the monsoon. Okay? That's called the potential. Now, as the rain stop in July, August, if it's the southwest monsoon that the area relies on, the dam will fill up. At that time, it will give you whatever it's designed for. The turbines will generate 500 megawatts, 200 megawatts, whatever it's sized for. As the water level in the dam falls, up to right through the year up to May, it will generate. Maybe in May, in fact, some power stations have to stop generating so that a small amount of water can be used for other purposes as well. You understand? So if you average out over the whole season, typical plant load factors in India are this. You can take data for a number of years, it comes to roughly this number, 0.37. So again, it's a simple multiplication to show that if I exploit 40%, which seems quite possible, then I could probably get 193 with that plant load factor. I may be able to plot up to 80%, in which case we could probably go up to even double that, that is 386 terawatt hours. It's a large amount of electricity which we can tap. But there are issues here, again, social issues with large power plants. And all of you who are in Gujarat at least should know that while there is a part of set of people who would like the dam on the Narmada rivers which have been built and are being built, there are many who are opposed to it also, because there are people being displaced. The flora and fauna is destroyed when land gets immersed in water behind a dam. You understand? There are various human problems which have to be addressed, apart from problems of ecology also to be addressed. So there is opposition also to large dams being built, which wasn't there 50 years ago. This is new, and there are two sides to the question. On the one side, you want electricity. On the other side, obviously, you should not be displacing people and say, go away, there's a dam coming, your village is going to be immersed. They have a case also. They've been staying in that village or that small town for hundreds of years, their families have been staying. So there is always this problem, and it's going to be there for our large dams. It's not going to go away so easily. But that's the potential. I must also tell you that hydroelectric power, large dams, there are worries that seismic activity in that region increases. For instance, in Maharashtra, for instance, we have the Koyna Dam. Okay, and you know there was a large earthquake in the Koyna area in 1967. The Koyna Dam was built in the 50s. Seismic activity in that region has increased after the dam was built. That is based on actual data. By seismic activity, I mean something that you can record, you know, Richter scale 3, 3.1, 3.5. You can record, it's continuously recorded. It has increased in that area, and in 67 there was a large earthquake which actually destroyed a fair amount of property and people died in it. So there is evidence to indicate an increase in seismic activity when large dams are built. And again, that worry is there that when there's a large earthquake, again lives will be lost. So there are issues which have to be sorted out. There is no question about it. Now, apart from large units. By large units, I mean 25 megawatts and more. That's a rough definition that's used. Small units can also be set up in streams, which are more, shall I say, seasonal in their character. All over in the Ghats, Western Ghats, and in the East, Eastern Ghats or in the Himalayas, there are seasonal streams which come, arise, which flow only during the monsoon or when rains come. You understand? One can have small turbines, run-of-the-river turbines, and get reasonable amounts of power. And there are careful surveys done all over India where these streams exist, where are likely places you can put up these small plants with water turbines to generate power. It has been estimated that one could generate, have a capacity of at least 15,384. This is a summing up of all the places which are listed. One can get lists of these where they are available. Already, we have about 5,000 megawatts installed in the country of these small units. And again, there is a potential for increasing them. Particularly, run-of-the-river schemes don't cause any flooding behind them. There's no dam built, so to speak. And there is potential for getting these small amounts, which could, if 40% is exploited, give you 20 terawatt hours. If 80% is exploited, give you even 40 terawatt hours, right? So there is a small potential which needs to be tapped in this field. Now we come to wind energy, which also has grown tremendously in terms of its capacity in India and all over the world, again in the last 30-40 years. It's very interesting for wind energy. Wind energy was a major source of power in many countries in the 30s, 100 years ago, when there wasn't much electricity even in the United States. In the Midwest, there were all these small windmills. There was no power lines running across the country then. There were all these small windmills which used to generate a few kilowatts, and households would get electricity or use the mechanical energy directly for some purpose. Then when electrification came, people said, let's build larger windmills. And the moment they went to larger windmills, you need larger size blades, okay? And those days, blades were made out of wood. Now, wood is a nice material, but not for windmills, in the sense, first of all, it's heavy. And secondly, it doesn't have the kind of life you need if you're spinning around even at 20 or 30 RPM. So very quickly, it became apparent in the 30s when people went for building even a 1 megawatt wind machine that, you know, it wouldn't last. And the biggest ones which were built were immediately in a few days or something, the blades broke off and things like that. And people lost interest in wind machines or wind energy as a large source of power. Kilowatts here, there doesn't add up too much. You understand? But a revolution began in the 70s. Composites came along. Okay? A composite material which has got composite of something which gives it strength and plastic is now what is being used in wind machines for blades. And the blades are now, 10, 15, 20 meters in size, in length. And so your wind machine is huge all over. And I'm sure if you're been to Saurashtra or all along the coast anywhere, you'll see wind machines all over, particularly in Gujarat, in Saurashtra, for instance, or in Tamil Nadu along the coast, in Maharashtra also, in the Ghats area and so on. All over the place, wind machines are there, and the growth has been spectacular. Today, we already, again, I've not updated to this year, but even till last year, the value was about 33,000 megawatts, and it's growing at the rate of about 10,000 megawatts every year, wind energy machines. Plant load factors are again low. There's no way out of that. And again, with the wind, typically winds are available only for 4-5 hours a day, which can be tapped. Now, why I say this is the following. If you look at the power generated, look at the equation which tells you how much power a wind machine generates, it's proportional to the cube of the velocity, rho av cubed. Okay, that gives you the power being generated in a wind machine, it's proportional to that. And that means below a certain velocity, which is typically around say 3 meters a second, it's not worth running the wind machine. That's the speed above which only you will get something from it. So typically there is a cut in speed which is around 3 meters a second, and then 4, 5, 6 you can go. Above 6 it starts getting dangerous. If you let it run with the wind, you will break off the blade. You understand? It's a cut out speed. So there is a range in which it has to run. And typically with that kind of limitation all over the world, You have some limitations of how many hours a day you can run it, particularly because of the cut-in speed, and typically you have to have therefore automatically a low plant load factor. But the potential is very high for wind, and typically latest findings are that we have as much in India, we have the potential for as much as 2000 gigawatts, that's 2 million megawatts of power could be capacity could be installed in the country. And this has been done very scientifically for wind machines. What they have is, what people have done is, they have maps of India, which you of course available. You look at every few square kilometers of area, make the country into, the map into squares, I think 1 square kilometer or some such size they do it, or less. And ask yourself from data for wind, is the velocity there on an average more than some density, like 250 watts per meter squared or some such value. If it is, it's a potential area where you can put a wind machine. Then you ask yourself the question, is that plot of land in a forest area? Okay, then you can't use it. Is it on a mountain slope? Then it's tough to use. So you eliminate all those things. So you select a plot first for its wind potential, then you select, leave out plots where you can't put wind machines, then you add them all up and you get this number which we have. So it's been done reasonably scientifically what that potential is. And it's again a very big potential right now. Right now, India is exploiting the ones that are obvious. In Saurashtra, along the coast, etc., these are obvious places which are being used for the generating. So I do the same calculation, which I won't repeat. In the case of wind, remember the height of the wind machine, the hub of the machine from the ground is important. Wind velocities increase as you go away from the ground. So that's again a big development, that now wind machines typically have hub heights which are 60, 70, 80 meters, the axis, the horizontal axis of the on which it rotates. Typically that height, the big machines which generate 7, 8 megawatts each are at that height from the ground. And the blades typically have a length, radius of that wind machine, typically maybe up to 20 meters even. So we're talking of very giant size machines, not small wind machines that generated kilowatts anymore. So with these numbers, one can show that wind has a potential for being a big contributor in the future in India. And if we exploit 20% even, we could get 700 terawatt hours. We exploit 60%, which may be possible, we could get 2,100 terawatt hours, which again, you must all the time keep comparing with the number that I put yesterday, 6,800, as a total that we need at least for renewables to be part, I mean, the major contributors to the energy scene. Okay. Now, there's one more aspect to wind, which is again a development of the last 10, 15 years. And that is wind machines now are being put up in large numbers offshore. You know, every country has a zone offshore, which is its zone. It's, I think, 200 kilometers from the shore or 100 kilometers, I've lost it. That's your economic zone. Other countries can't build it. You know, every country has that, if it has the sea around it. Offshore, that is in water, huge wind machines have been installed over the last few years. Already, countries like Germany, Denmark, to some extent England, are exploiting the sea around them to put up wind machines. And the day is not far when we will also do the same thing. They cost more, obviously, because now you're talking of putting foundations offshore. But that technology is not something new. You know, we've been drilling oil offshore for years. So if you can put structures from which you can drill down into the earth's surface, certainly you can put structures on which you can have wind machines standing. That's civil engineering. Civil engineers are good now. They make huge, massive structures which last. So that technology is there. Germany, Denmark are already exploiting wind energy offshore. And as I said, India will probably do the same, maybe 5-10 years from today. The potential has been roughly estimated to be around 1100 terawatt hours per year. We could generate that much energy from wind machines offshore. More detailed, I think, studies by our ministry are going on what exactly we can, how much exactly is the potential. But this is a fairly good estimate which has come from some sources that we may be able to get that much. And again, if I even take 20% of that, I could get to 20 terawatt hours. If 60% is done, even 660 terawatt hours. So it's going to be a reasonably big contributor to the energy scene. This is just a picture of a wind machine. Now I add up. I said these are the major contributors. So let's do an addition. Solar power, so much. The minimum was with the minimum I thought it could generate, maximum. And add them up. Biomass, I didn't show you any calculations. But typically, India can't generate all that much because biomass is used also a lot for cooking purposes and so on. The wood, the stray, the straw, etc. gets used in different ways. So typically an estimate is all the other sources including biomass probably generate 70 to 80 terawatt hours. These are estimates made by other people which I have used. But add it all up and what you are getting now is a number which comes to this 6514 terawatt hours. Okay, that's the number that I am getting, which shows we could generate so much eventually from renewable sources. And it's a big number in the sense it could be a substantial contributor. Renewable sources could be a substantial contributor to the electricity scene in India in the future. That's effectively what we are saying. All right. So, what I said just now, I've written there. On an annual basis, the estimated maximum production 6514 terawatt hours indicates a significant part of the total need can be met eventually 30, 40 years from today. But now I ask the question, is this enough? If I say this, are you happy? What are the problems now? And those are the technical challenges that I want to now talk about. It is not enough to compare the demand with supply on an annual basis alone. One year I get so much from the wind, so much I need, and I say that's fine. No. I want electricity round the clock. This wind machine will run for those 4 or 5 hours and give me electricity. The solar panels will run for those 8 hours a day and give me electricity. Does that mean 24 hours I'll get what I want? The answer is no. I need to match. I need to feed into a grid and I need to take out of the grid something which is of a more continuous type, not something erratic like this is. So, the two big challenges before us, before not just India but any country which wants to use renewable energy on a large scale is, number one, that our power grids have to become smart grids in the future. And if that happens only, will we be able to what you call match supply with demand. Where is the supply? If it's coming from renewables, it's literally thousands and thousands of windmills and photovoltaic plants supplying megawatt here, a megawatt there, 10 megawatts here, 100 megawatts here, like that, all over the country. You understand? Or wind machines. And on the other side, in towns and villages and so on, there are some things like factories which need electricity 24 hours a day. There are other places in towns where there's a 24-hour variation depending upon when a peak occurs in that town. Typically, for instance, peaks occur in a town in the evening, 7 or 8 o'clock, when you have just finished eating and you want to watch your TV, and if your ACs are on in summer, that's the time when really peak occurs in summer in many of our cities, right? So you've got to be able to match these two, and that's where, you know, electronics and electrical engineering and IT and all is going to come in. And these are going to be very big challenges because solar and wind energy are intermittent sources, and if they are to supply the bulk of our energy in the future, power grids will have to be smart grids. Now, I think I missed one slide here. Just to show you the type of fluctuations that occur. Look, this is a typical fluctuation of wind on a day in Gurgaon near Delhi, taken a few years ago. Okay, and it's only above 3 meters a second that it's useful energy. Below 3, probably the wind machine will be in a cutout state. It won't be operating. Or if you go back, here's solar energy measurements on a typical sunny day in Gurgaon, about few years ago taken data. A typical half sine wave kind of thing. You understand? 16 hours a day, no energy. 8 hours a day, a kind of a half sine wave, roughly as an approximation. That's what we've got. So, smart power grids have to have properties something like this. They coordinate and control the supply of thousands of relatively small, distributed, fluctuating solar and wind power sources. And they, you have to take that supply through the power grid, a robust grid, and then control and manage power consumption of thousands of consumers, control and manage the power consumption of thousands of consumers on the demand side. That's the kind of matching needed, which has to be done through smart grids, not the way we do it just now when power is coming in from a coal-fired station. If Ahmedabad is taking too much power, they simply say, okay, this part of Ahmedabad won't get for 2 hours a day. They won't get for 2 hours this thing. You know, and that's how load shedding is done. Load shedding is not the answer for the future. You've got to have grids which do this in a reasonable manner so that everyone is happy, not cut out something totally from the, cut out some part totally. The other big challenge is that when the energy is available in excess from a renewable source, you need to store it. Now, you know, the obvious answer when you say electricity is to be stored, you say use a battery, what's the problem? It's all right if you're talking of 1 kilowatt hour to be stored or 10 kilowatt hours to be stored. I'm not talking of that, I'm talking of 100 terawatt hours to be stored over a day in some batteries. Batteries cost money, the latest best batteries are lithium batteries, okay? And there's a limit to how much you can do with batteries. So electricity is very nice as a source of power if you use it immediately. Electricity is not so nice if you have to store it. That's where solar thermal comes in. You see, a fluid like say a hot molten salt, during the day if you run a solar thermal power plant, you can let that hot molten salt get hot up to 500 centigrade, store it in big tanks, okay, and then once the sun has gone down for the 16 hours when the sun isn't there, run that power plant with that hot molten salt. It will generate steam, that steam will run turbines, that turbines will run generators, you would get your electricity. So if you have a hybrid of solar PV plus solar thermal, the PV does its job during the day, the solar thermal does what it has collected during the day, uses it at night. So that's the kind of thinking that's come in if you want to, has to come in if you want to manage this challenge of getting power more continuously. So just one suggestion, it's being tried out already in some places. Okay, so there are issues of storage and I won't spend time on that now, but just say that storage is the other major challenge, storing energy whether in thermal form or as electricity. And of course, the economics is always an issue. You need money for everything. And if you don't have the money, well, forget everything. Now, I want to go to the last topic. Just briefly talk for 5 minutes on what we mean by sustainable development. Yesterday, I haven't used the word sustainable. I've used the word economic development. I used the word social development when I talked about an equitable distribution. But I didn't use the word sustainable. And to those of you who may not be familiar, at least I want to define the term for you because it's important for the future of all of us on the earth. I'll first talk about a study which was called the Limits to Growth study, which was came out, the reports came out in the 70s, which was a kind of a doomsday prediction. Okay, the Club of Rome, as it was called, brought out what we call as a doomsday prediction, look, saying if on earth we continue doing what we are doing today, by the end of the century, we are going to be in serious trouble. Why? Because we are using up resources far too fast and then we'll be left with nothing. You use up non-renewable sources like coal and oil, finished. Why are you going to get the other things? Nobody thought then that renewables even would be big sources of power. Or your needs for food are increasing daily. How, to what extent can you get food to be supplied as more and more people want good living and things like that. So, the Limits to Growth basically was a report which came out in the 70s to say that we are approaching a kind of a doomsday in the world. And although that has not happened so far, the fact is what it said made a big impact, because while the calculations or the rate at which it would happen may not have been right, the problems that they raised together certainly caught the attention of people. All right. So, this was a study conducted at MIT by a set of people, and the study analyzed the existing trends in economic growth and population in the world and noted that these growths were being accompanied by increases in food requirements, the use of non-renewable sources and pollution. Okay. That means side by side, the environmental issue started coming up in a big way in the 70s. Just to give you an example, I graduated from my college, engineering college, in the 50s, 50 years, more than 50 years ago. Okay. The word environment wasn't even mentioned in the class throughout the 4 years that I was in my engineering college. It never occurred to us that, you know, what's going up into the environment or what's polluting our rivers is something worth worrying about. The Ganga was nearby, people were freely use the Ganga. We worship it on one side, but throw all our junk into it in Banaras, as you well know. You understand? So, the point is, that time environment was not an issue. Today it is. We know the harm that we are creating. So, times have changed. And that report concluded that if we continued in this fashion, it predicted, we were reaching what they called the limits to growth. And then after that, there would be major issues which would be faced by the world. So, as I said, this was a kind of a doomsday prediction. And the study went on to say, well, we need to do something about it. We can't just say it will happen and just watch. So, it went on to say, it would be necessary and possible to alter existing trends and adopt policies which would establish some kind of global equilibrium. And at the same time, maintain economic and environmental stability, which would be sustainable. You see that word there? That's one of the first times that that word was used. That you need to implement policies which will can sustain, not something that's taking us downhill slowly. This state of global equilibrium would need to be such that the basic material needs of each person were still satisfied. And it was, they felt it was possible if one was rational. From this, as I said, the term sustainable development came. And it was first used in a conference in Sweden somewhere in the 80s or something like that. Development which meets the needs now and in the future, note the words now and in the future, for human development, economic development and social development, this is what development means, within the restraints of the support systems of the earth. That's what we call as sustainable development. That means a sustainable energy system is one which ensures that it meets the needs of the present without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their needs. That you take something from the earth, but you have enough still, and without, as I said, making the ability for future generations needs to be satisfied. That's what we call a sustainable development. Leave the earth in a position that future generations have their hopes as well. That's important. That's where the term sustainable development came in. In order to make sustainable development, countries have to meet and agree on action plans which each has to undertake. Now, this is the point which comes out. Development, I can talk about India. I can say India should have economic development, become a developed country. India should have social issues, we should take care of them. Okay. India should have human development, yes. Education, etc., yes. But the moment I come to sustainable development, if India alone does sustainable development and others do, that effect I am going to feel, and or if I don't do it, they are going to feel it. So, sustainable development is not a one country show. It's a show which all countries, at least all major countries, have to participate. All major countries have to realize this in order that the sustainable development should really work. And that is where big countries come in. And I don't know if you read the newspapers, but the Paris Accord was the one that is one of the latest big meetings held. At that time, they talked about global warming, saying we got to control it. You can't let every year a little more carbon dioxide stay up there, prevent radiation from coming in, and therefore the atmosphere is growing just that little bit warmer every 10 years. Can't let that happen forever. So the Paris Accord 2 years ago, which India and all countries signed, was you've got to limit global warming to 2 degrees centigrade. And each country has to come up with a plan which will help towards that goal. And the goal I mentioned of India saying we'll have 170,000 megawatts is part of the Paris Accord. You understand? Now, some countries are going with full vigor at this, but again, if you read the newspapers, you will be aware that the United States has withdrawn from the Paris Accord, saying we don't want it. And that's a very dangerous move. One can say that openly, for one big country to say, we don't need it, we have no problems. Sustainable development is a problem for all. If I create some kind of problems of sending up more carbon dioxide, that's not going to stay only above India. That carbon dioxide is going to spread everywhere and create global warming for all of us. So it is necessary that the major contributors, the big countries, be part of this if it is to be something that is successful. And as I said, India in the Paris Agreement has agreed to this. So what are the implications for India if it is to be, shall I say, a mature contributor to the growth of sustainable development for the world? Considering its size and its population, India is not rich in resources, keep in mind. We know, they consider the resources of coal, oil, natural gas. I already told you yesterday, we have coal which is of poor quality, large amounts, but we have to import good quality coal. We have very little oil. We only drill and get about 10-20% of our oil from our own sources, 80% we import from the Middle East or other countries. It's the same with natural gas. So, if the need for sustainable development is accepted, the implications for India are clear. We must strive for a good life, an equitable life, that's social development, a simple life in which basic material needs are satisfied. However, we cannot afford an extravagant or wasteful life. So India is growing, and unfortunately there are many people who don't understand this and think that's all right to waste. I have money, I can waste it. But even with money, if you waste it, you are creating national problems. That education has to come to the country, that wastage, whether it be food or whether it be a resource, is something that hurts us, hurts the country and hurts the world as well. And that is something we have to drill into our education system so that it gets something that we believe in. And therefore, I come back to the question I asked yesterday. Do we want 1,840, which is a bare minimum? Do we want 4,000, which gives us an HDI of 0.9, which I mentioned yesterday? Or do we say, if Europe can have 7,000-8,000 and America can have 12,000 per kilowatt hours per person, why not India? We should have anything that we can pay for. And the answer is clear. India can give a good life to its citizen even with a mean of 4,000 kilowatt hours per person. That's why I used 4,000 in the calculations to reach 6,800, saying it's not just India, it's sustainable development that we have to push for, and India is a big country. If it pushes, it can influence other countries, saying we are doing it, why don't you also join in? And now let me just sum up. What have I said today and yesterday? What did we start with? We said, well, first of all, right now we are a country which depends heavily on fossil fuels for its growth, right? Electricity comes from fossil fuels. 80% of our energy comes from fossil fuels. We have to eventually change it because non-renewable energy sources have to go gradually, okay? And we have shown through the calculations that renewable energy sources, photovoltaics, solar thermal, perhaps as we go along and prices come down, and wind energy, onshore and offshore, hydroelectric power, all these if added up can give you reasonably large amounts of electricity which we can use. That's one thing we have come to. What we have also seen is it's not trivial anymore. When renewable sources supply 1 or 2 or 3% of our power, we can always feed it into the grid. The grid is essentially dominated by coal-fired stations which are constant in their output. 1-2% of here there doesn't bother it. Say, good, welcome. The moment renewable energy sources take over, their erraticness, their fluctuation with time starts affecting that grid. And therefore, we are going to have smart power grids. We need to have ways of storing large amounts of energy if we want to make this a reality. That's technical. That's going to need big solutions in the future. And then finally at the end, I came back to say, we have identified needs. Why do we need that 4,000 and stick to it? Because it's not just development of a country. It's not just economic, social and human development of India that we are concerned with. Every large country has to be part of the world family. And the world family has to look at sustainable development as everybody's problem. India is one of them. If we don't do that and say, my problem is only with the sky above me, I'll worry about it, doesn't happen that way. Okay? And therefore, it's necessary that we be frugal. And therefore, the suggestion which I made yesterday and I repeat today, that about 4,000 kilowatt hours per person per year would be a very good amount to stick for, to aim for, and yet get a good life for our people. So let me conclude now. I've taken more time than I wanted to. That always happens with professors. They love talking, you know. It's something they're born with, certainly for their own subject. At home, by the way, they keep quiet in front of their wives. They have to. Otherwise, you know, they'll say, "Wahan bhi lecture dete ho, yahan bhi lecture dete ho." That doesn't work. So keep that in mind for your futures also. So let me conclude, but if you have time and if you're not too late and you have questions, I'll be glad to answer them. Thank you.